Welcome to this presentation covering Chapter 12. In this chapter, we're going to discuss trial procedures, and these will be focused on civil trial procedures. Let's get started. We've talked about this theme in past chapters, but it bears repeating. Trials are not a win for anyone. Certainly, people are successful at trial, But it's rare for either side to go into trial thinking, oh, this is awesome, this is wonderful, this is exactly what we wanted to have happen. The reason for that is that in some sense, both sides have already lost if you go to trial, because it's guaranteed that it's going to cost a lot of money for both sides, and it's going to take a lot of time, and it's going to be a very stressful experience for the folks involved in the particular matter. It's going to kind of take over their lives for a matter of at least days, sometimes weeks, sometimes months. There's a certain level of uncertainty. If everyone knew how the trial was going to end up, what the jury was going to decide, there'd be no reason to have a trial. And in fact, the parties would just settle. So there has to be something that there's a little bit of a question mark about. And whenever there's a question mark, it can go good for you or it can go very, very bad for you. And so those are factors, those are reasons why trials or getting to trial is rarely a good thing. Now, of course, you can go to trial, you can reluctantly go to trial and end up getting an awesome result. And so I don't mean to say that people are never happy at the end of a trial. They certainly can be. In fact, oftentimes are happy. But the idea of having to go to trial is not a pleasant or happy thought. The only people who are maybe a little bit happy about it are the legal professionals, the paralegals and the attorneys. So the takeaway is that virtually everyone wants to avoid trial if possible. And there's a few ways that this can be accomplished. The big one, the most important one, is that the parties can settle out of court. They can reach a resolution their matter. This is something that the court will very much want to encourage. And in fact, courts are kind of known in many cases for doing a little bit of strong-arming of the parties, making the parties feel a little bit uncomfortable about not settling if they are perceived to be the impediment to why the case is not settling. Cases can settle at any point. They can settle even before the first document is filed, even before there's a court to even hear the case. Or they can settle right after the lawsuit is filed. Or they can settle at any point through the pretrial procedures. They can settle on the eve of trial. This is oftentimes called settling on the courthouse steps. They can settle in the middle of trial. I've had one case that settled in the middle of a trial. That's not an uncommon thing to happen. Cases can settle when the jury's out on deliberations. They can settle right after the jury has come in and announced its verdict. And of course, cases can settle at any point after that, including during the appeal. So there's really no limit to the time that a case can settle, but a fairly common time for cases to settle is right before trial. People recognize, okay, this is kind of our last best opportunity. Very shortly, the attorneys are going to be ginning up a lot of hours, and it's going to become very, very expensive. And so there is the desire at that point to settle. Let me pause and talk a little bit about the cost factor. I know I kind of didn't go into exactly why it's costly. There are several reasons. Obviously, the source of the cost is primarily the attorneys and paralegals. The time that they're going to be spending on the case is going to cause there to be significant attorney's fees. Now, sometimes a party might think, well, but I'm going to win the lawsuit, so why do I care about the attorney's fees? In the American system, traditionally and usually, the parties pay their own legal bills. So when I win, I pay my legal bills. When I lose, I pay my legal bills. There is rarely an opportunity for the jury to award attorney's fees. It happens under certain statutes. It certainly can happen, but most of the time, in the majority of situations, in the significant majority of situations, the parties are going to pay their legal bills whether they win or they lose. So winning or losing, obviously winning, it's, you have money to pay the bills, but the bills are going to come due. So that we call this the American system. Other countries have different systems. The British system, for example, is different. In that system, the loser pays. So if I win at trial, I'm going to probably get some kind of verdict, especially if I'm the plaintiff, and get some kind of damage award. And I'm not going to have to pay my attorney's fees. The other side is going to have to pay my attorney's fees. So I kind of win twice under that scenario, which is a pretty happy place to be. But let's imagine the reverse. I lose. Well, if I'm the plaintiff, I lose, meaning I don't get any money. But it's not a simple matter of just walking out, not getting any money. I'm still going to have to pay my attorney, and I'm going to have to pay the other side's attorney. So those can be several hundred thousand dollars pretty quickly, certainly $150,000 to $200,000 in a jury trial is kind of a threshold amount if you're paying for both sides. Of course, if I'm on the defense side and I lose, I'm probably going to be paying the plaintiff some a jury verdict, and then I'm going to be paying my own legal bills, and then I'm going to be paying the plaintiff's legal bills. So you can see, even if the jury verdict itself isn't huge, adding all those attorney's fees, it becomes much, much more significant. Some people hypothesize that this British system, loser pays system, is one of the reasons why there's less litigation in Great Britain than there is in the United States, because it's just too scary, the idea of suing when there's a possibility that you may have to pay the other guy's legal bills. Most ordinary people don't have an extra $100,000 sitting around their bank account. They especially don't have an extra $100,000 sitting around their bank account when they are the person who is considering a lawsuit, because usually that means something hasn't gone quite right in their lives, and probably they don't have as much money as they think that they should have. So as a result, they're only going to file a lawsuit if they feel like, boy, there's just almost certainly they're going to win the case. And so as a result, some people hypothesize that lawsuits in Great Britain are less frequent because of that reason. But in any event, we're in the American system, and so that means both sides are going to pay their own legal bills in the vast majority of times. And as a result, the idea of settlement is very appealing to both sides. The mechanism by which you reach settlement can vary, but a common one is using ADR, alternative dispute resolution. This is the system of settling cases and using some mechanism, and there's three big ones, but there's other ways of going about that as well. So really these two bullets you could combine and say an out-of-court settlement through an alternative dispute resolution tool is one way to avoid a trial. The other one, though, is to get the lawsuit dismissed. This is most commonly done by the defense side. It's one of the reasons, actually, why defendants, civil defendants, really like to be in federal court, because the federal rules of civil procedure are more inclined to result in the dismissal of cases than in most state rules. And that's certainly true in Texas. The Texas rules of civil procedure are less likely to result in the dismissal of a lawsuit. So you may say, well, how does a lawsuit get dismissed? Doesn't the jury get to hear the case? Does the jury decide whether the case has merit? Well, that's the idea, and that's what happens most of the time if the case doesn't settle. But there can be lawsuits that the court perceives are frivolous, that they don't have a sound legal basis or a sound factual basis. And under those circumstances, the court may say it doesn't make sense to inconvenience a jury to hear a case when really it's pretty obvious how the case ought to be decided. Plus, since both sides pay their own legal bills, it's really not fair to the defendant to make him spend $100,000 in litigation when it's pretty darn obvious that the plaintiff doesn't have a reasonable case. And so the court files a motion might be filed. The most common one is a motion for summary judgment. And then what the court files, of course, is a summary judgment. And so what a summary judgment is, as you can see by the name, it's a brief judgment. It's a judgment that happens out before the jury gets involved in hearing a particular case. And so that's a mechanism that a case can be dismissed. These are called dispositive motions, in that they dispose of the case. Plaintiffs can file dispositive motions. Of course, if a plaintiff files a dispositive motion and it's granted, it means that the lawsuit is over and the court has ruled that the plaintiff has won. Those are much less common because the plaintiff bears the burden of proof. And so the judge really, really, really has to see that the case is super, super strong for the plaintiff before the judge can just say, no, the defendant's not entitled to a trial. It's just obvious that the plaintiff is going to win. Another reason why cases typically are not disposed of on a plaintiff's motion is that the plaintiff is going to be entitled, if the plaintiff wins, is going to be entitled to some kind of damages. Well, how is that amount calculated? Even if it's obvious that the plaintiff is responsible, or the defendant is responsible legally for whatever happened to the plaintiff, you still have to figure out how much money the defendant is going to have to pay. Of course, when the defendant wins, the defendant isn't going to pay anything. So it's pretty darn easy to calculate zero. So those are the distinctions in those areas. So there's the two paths where lawsuits can avoid trial. One is through a settlement mechanism where the two parties agree. The other is through some dispositive motion typically filed by the defendant. Paralegals are really involved in trial. They are the people who are going to be doing lots of, I'm going to call them behind the scenes tasks, but they're not really behind the scenes. Typically the paralegal is going to be seated next to the attorney, and he or she is going to be very much in the thick of things, dealing with witnesses, dealing with documents, supporting the litigation effort in lots and lots of different ways. And so we're going to explore how that works out. But before we do, let's pause for a second and talk about some ways that here we go. I'm just going to try to find something here for a second. I apologize. I'm going to look for one little thing. Okay, here we go. Okay, so I'm going to do a little bit of a drawing here. Okay, let's imagine a law firm. We have a partner here, and we'll say that there are several associates who report to the partner. We're going to call this first one associate. You may recall, associate is a term for an attorney who is on partnership track. An associate is an employee of the law firm, a licensed attorney, and his expectation is that one day he'll become a partner. It doesn't always happen by any means, but it probably happens less commonly than it doesn't, but it certainly is one way that a person's employment can be resolved if one is an associate. We're also going to add one staff attorney. A staff attorney is an employee of the law firm, but he typically does not have the expectation of becoming a partner. Typically, a staff attorney is hired as a staff attorney and remains a staff attorney throughout his employment. Sometimes staff attorneys will get, I guess you could call it, promoted to associate, and sometimes associates will become staff attorneys. There can be lots of different reasons why changes happen, lots of different reasons why someone is a staff attorney. Probably the most common reason is that the staff attorney has a less, we'll say, distinguished background, maybe a less impressive law school, maybe less impressive workplace skills or resume. Another reason that sometimes a person is a staff attorney instead of an associate is that the associate has decided that he or she wants to kind of drop out of the rat race to some extent and doesn't want to be expected to bill quite as many hours or work quite as hard. And so that person might take on a staff attorney position. Sometimes this is even a part-time position, it can be. Sometimes an associate attorney doesn't make partner but wants to continue in the law firm. Traditionally, if an associate doesn't make partner, he or she leaves the law firm at that time. And that certainly does happen today, but it's also a possibility that that attorney will request and perhaps be allowed to stay as a staff attorney. Anyway, that's kind of beyond the scope of what we're talking about here, but we have this partner who has six attorneys with whom we'll say this is a Mrs. Partner here or Ms. Partner that she supervises. And let's say that there are two paralegals. So we'll have paralegal one and paralegal two. In most law firms, there's going to be more attorneys than there are paralegals. And so in this situation, this legal group, the folks who are doing substantive legal work, number nine, partner, six attorneys, and two paralegals. When, let's say, attorney three is getting ready to go to trial, it's almost certain that he is going to want to take at least one person with him to assist at trial. It could be a more junior attorney. He could, for example, invite attorney five. But it's more common than not, especially if it's a smaller matter, that he's going to invite one of the paralegals. It would be fairly unusual for an attorney to go to trial and not bring a paralegal. I'm not going to say it never happens, but it's more common. So certainly the majority of time that's going to happen. So think about it. If all of these attorneys, if each one of them goes to trial twice a year, we'll say that they go to trial once a year, okay? So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We have seven trials. So if let's say it's broken up evenly, this one gets four trials in that year. This one gets three trials in that year. Actually, we'll say one trial, no paralegals involved. So we'll say it's 3 and 3. You can still see, though, that the paralegals get more trial experience typically than the attorneys do. That's not an uncommon phenomenon to consider. Anyway, let's go back to our other screen, our PowerPoint screen. Okay, so we're back to our PowerPoint screen. Let me go to our next slide. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about preparing for trial. The trial itself can last even just a few hours up to months, but much of the work or much of the billable time that one spends related to trial occur well before the trial begins. And these are tasks that paralegals are pretty routinely involved with. Keep in mind that at this point, you're not too far from trial. You will have, or someone in your law firm at least, will have talked to all of the witnesses and interviewed them and all that good stuff. But from the time that a matter arises or a lawsuit is filed until the time you go to trial, that can be years. And as a result, witnesses may have moved to different cities, may have gotten different jobs, may have changed telephone numbers or addresses. All kinds of things can change. And so finding them can be a challenge. And reminding them why you're contacting them and reacquainting them with the process, what's going on, is very likely something you're going to want to do. And to some extent, you kind of have to wait until you're reasonably close to trial, because after all, with the passage of time, people are going to forget things. So you want things to be fresh in their minds. It's a good idea to subpoena all witnesses. A subpoena, of course, is a court order that requires that person who's going to be a witness at trial appear in court. You may think, well, why do you want to, it's probably obvious why you want to subpoena hostile witnesses. And just a little reminder what a hostile witness is. A hostile witness is not necessarily a mean person or an unpleasant person. A hostile witness is a witness for the other side. He or she may be completely charming and may be completely charming to you, but the testimony that he or she is going to be giving is helpful to the other side, not helpful to your side as a general rule. And so that's what we call a hostile witness. We call friendly witnesses the witnesses that are on your side. And again, they might be friendly, they might be charming, lovely people, or they might be mean, awful, dreadful people. We're not saying anything about their character or their temperament. What we're saying is they're going to help us. Their testimony is a positive for us. So you can immediately see why you need to subpoena the hostile witnesses that you're going to decide that you need to call. You may say, well, would you want to call a hostile witness? Well, a witness who's negative or prone to be on the side, it doesn't mean that every single bit of his or her testimony is negative for you. It's not unusual for a bad witness, somebody who is going to say maybe 90% bad things about your case, may have one really important good thing to say, and it may be important enough that you're going to still call them as a witness so you can get that one piece of testimony in. So there can be very good reasons why you subpoena hostile witnesses, but it's obvious why you want to call friendly witnesses. You may think, well, why do I need a subpoena friendly witnesses? Well, there can be lots of reasons for that. One thing about friendly witnesses is that sometimes a witness can present as a friendly witness, but that witness really isn't friendly at the end of the day. Let me share a very sad story from my own experience. Okay, I'm gonna start here. Okay, so we have Bob. Bob is an employee of ABC Company. Another employee of ABC Company, actually she's a former employee, is Sally. Actually, let's change that. I think Sally was actually a current employee now that I'm thinking about it. She is also an employee of ABC Company. Anyway, this was a warehouse, and Sally was a rather young woman, maybe 30 to 35, was attractive, and was somewhat of an atypical employee for this warehouse. Most people in the warehouse were men, they were older. She was certainly the most photogenic, we'll say, of the group of employees there. Bob was the big boss in the facility. Anyway, Sally alleged that Bob was sexually harassing her. And not just sexually harassing her, but also doing other kind of weird stuff. In a warehouse environment, you're going to have mice and rats in it from time to time. Anyway, Sally alleged that when she rebuffed Bob's advances, Bob started putting the dead rats in the drawers of her desk, knowing that she was, you know, not comfortable seeing the dead rats. And so she saw it as some kind of retaliation. Anyway, she filed a lawsuit. She was still an employee at this time. And she filed a lawsuit against Bob and also against their employer, saying that ABC should have made Bob behave better. Well, I was called into the case, and I met with Bob, and I'll admit to you, Bob kind of gave me the heebie-jeebies. He was a little bit of an odd person, and it was fairly easy to kind of see how maybe Sally was telling the truth. Didn't know if Sally was telling the truth or not, but Bob just made you feel a little bit uncomfortable. Just being around him, it's hard to say exactly what it was, but you just felt an uncomfortable vibe, and you thought to yourself, the jury's going to get this vibe as well. So it was kind of a tough case beginning, but Bob had a first lieutenant, I guess, a kind of an assistant, and we'll say his name was Bill. Anyway, Bill was everything Bob wasn't. Bill was nice looking, not GQ nice looking, but you know, more attractive, we'll say, than Bob. Was more articulate, more poised, was more pleasant to be around him. We all kind of thought at the time, boy, why was Bob the boss? Bill should be the boss. But Bill was significantly younger than Bob, and so you could imagine that Bill was being groomed maybe when Bob retired to take over Bob's job. Anyway, Bill, when I finally met with Bill, Bill was very reassuring. He told me, well, you know, I know Bob's a little bit odd, but no, Sally's making up this story. Bob never did any of those things. Yeah, there may have been a dead rat, but I mean, there's dead rats in warehouses. The idea that Bob put it there is just silly. And no, I've never seen or heard Bob do anything towards Sally that was inappropriate. And some of the things Sally says Bob did, no, they just couldn't have happened. So I have to tell you, once I talked to Bill, I felt much better about the case, much more reassured that Sally's just making up a story and that really Bob is probably harmless. So the case proceeded, and we got to the discovery process, and eventually we were in some depositions and some interrogatories as well. And it just seemed like Sally's attorney was always one step ahead of us. We'd find out about something, and then it seemed like Sally knew about it too, and we couldn't quite figure out how she knew about it. Because we were required to share that information with Sally, but sometimes it seemed like Sally knew about it before we did. And maybe there were some good guesses, but it just seemed like that was happening too often. The case proceeded for a while, and it was now time for Bill to be deposed. So we prepped him. He knew what to say. He was a poised, articulate person. We weren't really worried about what he was going to say. But in preparation for this, and actually at the deposition, some of the questions that Bill were asked were just things we didn't see how Sally's attorney would know. And of course, Bill was honest that there were some bad facts in our case, and Bill was required, obviously, to share the bad facts. You know, he did it reluctantly, but he did it truthfully, as he was supposed to do. Anyway, the case continued on, and I continued to kind of just not think Bob was that good of a guy, but I really came to appreciate and enjoy my time with Bill and thought he was a good stand-up guy. Then someone came forward and said that they had seen Bill and Sally at a local restaurant in the evening. And so that was kind of weird. We weren't quite sure what to make of that. A little bit of investigation, though, revealed that Bill was a routine visitor at Sally's apartment, and even an overnight visitor at Sally's apartment. And it came clear pretty eventually that Bill was playing us both, or at least playing us. I don't know if she was playing Sally or not. But Bill was acting as if he was on our side so that we would give lots of information, but then he was feeding information to Sally. And I, to this day, I'm not sure if Sally was telling the truth about Bob or whether the whole thing was a scam, but certainly Bill's involvement he was involved in the scam. But if someone hadn't seen Bill and Sally together at that restaurant, or I can't remember the specifics, but something like that, we never would have figured that out. And so the person we thought was a friendly witness was probably more of a hostile witness than a friendly witness. So the takeaway is that just because you think a witness is friendly doesn't mean that that person really is friendly. They might be, but they also might be playing you. And so keep that in mind, the designations between hostile and friendly. But let's say you're certain that person is a friendly witness. You just know it. Okay. That may be the case, but there's still two reasons why you still want to subpoena that friendly witness. One is the witness may be frightened, intimidated by the process. They may act as if, oh yeah, I'm fully on board, I'm not worried about it at all, but they wake up that morning and they think, oh my gosh, going to court, I don't know what to wear, I don't know what to say, I'm just not going to go. They have that moment of panic, or maybe not panic, just discomfort. And since, after all, they're just a witness, they're not getting anything out of the case, they may decide not to come. But if they know they can be thrown in jail if they don't come, boy, that's a motivator. And so friendly witnesses can suddenly find something more important to you that day, frequently, if you don't subpoena them. And the last reason that you want to subpoena even friendly witnesses is that employers, especially larger employers, will often pay for the wages of people who were subpoenaed to testify. But many times the employer requires that subpoena to show that it wasn't the witness's own choice whether to go or not. And so as a result, you may be able to earn that witness some extra money to make up, you know, for the time that they had to take off work. And so that's obviously a good thing for the witness. And if you can get the witness happy, that's a witness who's going to be a little bit more cooperative. So keep that in mind. Don't assume that you can avoid subpoenas. You want to subpoena everybody that you think you're going to call. And you oftentimes subpoena people that you end up not calling. That's perfectly fine. Paralegals are also often involved in preparing witnesses. A lot of it is pretty straightforward stuff. How do you get to the courthouse? Where is the courthouse located? How does parking work at the courthouse? You have to go through a metal detector. So don't bring in, if you have a concealed carry license, you don't want to bring that gun into the courthouse, obviously. You want to talk to them about where they're going to go. Where's the witness room? What do they need to bring with them? What is the correct clothing to wear? Where can they not go? For example, they may be tempted to go into the courtroom, just curious to see how the trial is going. But in most cases, witnesses aren't allowed in the courtroom except for the period of time that they're testifying. Witnesses can go and look in other courtrooms, but the problem with that is that if they're visiting another courtroom, then how will you find them when it's time for them to be called? So typically they're going to wait in a central place, waiting room type situation where they can be called. And they may be there for quite a while, and so it's a good idea for them to bring a newspaper, a magazine, or something for them to do. That they won't be so very bored. Typically there's a television or something like that in the room as well. So you want to let them know what to expect in the courthouse. You also want to practice with them how the testimony is going to go. So you'll have role playing where you'll ask the questions that you expect the person will be asked to answer, and then you'll have that person practice their answers. This, you will have already probably done this when they were preparing for their deposition, but not everybody gets deposed, so this might be some folks' first exposure to this. And so you'll talk through things. You'll suggest that they wait 2 or 3 seconds before they actually start their testimony after the question has been completed. That gives an opportunity for both sides to make an objection if they want to. You'd also talk about waiting until the question is complete so that you know exactly what the question is, and that you can pause for a moment and think about crafting your answer. We'll also talk about the fact that you don't want to volunteer information. You want to answer the question truthfully and completely, but not go down answer questions that haven't been asked. You'll want to talk about the importance of being truthful and what that means. There may be certain questions that you're expecting to ask of a friendly witness that you are looking for a particular type of answer. For example, let's say it's a car accident case, and the attorney is going to ask something like, what happened on June 17th, 2012? Well, probably the attorney doesn't want a description of, well, I got out of my bed that morning, I brushed my teeth. Oh, wait a second. Now, did I get dressed first or did I brush my teeth? Oh, gosh, I can't remember because I put on my blue slacks. Oh, but then I remembered that I shouldn't wear those. I should wear jeans instead because I was going to be doing some kind of messy work at work that day. And so then, yeah, because then I switched to the blue jeans, and that's when I brushed my teeth. And I also put on a plaid shirt. It's my favorite. I got it, from my great aunt Mabel, and it just really looks nice. It's kind of a green with a little gold thread through it. No, that's not what we want. You want certain pieces of information to be brought out. Most likely that attorney wanted you to talk about the events leading up to the accident that are relevant. So going back to the question might be, what happened on, June 17th, 2012? Your answer might be, I was in an automobile accident in Frisco at the corner of, Preston and Main Street. That might be the answer they're looking for. In addition, so that's direct testimony. The direct testimony is the testimony that the attorney will elicit from his friendly witness. In some sense, that's kind of a scripted thing. You don't want it to be too scripted because you want it to sound spontaneous. If it sounds too scripted, the jury will get bored, and maybe the jury will even find it not very credible because it is too rehearsed. But you want it also to be fairly predictable because attorneys rarely get as much time as they would like to present a case. And so the attorney might have ideally wanted 3 weeks to present all of his evidence. Well, maybe he gets, 6 days or, 10 days or something. So he's going to have to condense stuff. So if the witness kind of goes off on this tangent or that tangent that's really not relevant, starts discussing, for example, what he wore on that particular day, even though what he wore is not significant to the case, you want to be able to prepare the witness and before the case, have him or her know what testimony is useful and what testimony isn't. The attorney can't really interrupt the witness and say, no, that's not what you need to be telling me. Typically, an attorney can't object to his own witness's answers to questions. So kind of getting prepared can help avoid some of that and avoid the wasted time, which, of course, is frustrating for your side because you have so little time to present. And it's also annoying to the jury, who obviously would prefer to be doing other things with their time off of work. So that's direct examination, and you certainly want to practice with that, but you also want to practice with cross-examination. This is more tricky because, obviously, these are the questions, cross-examination is the question that the other side will ask your witness, your friendly witness, after the direct examination is done, after your attorney has finished with questions. And in some sense, you don't know what the cross-examination questions will be. You certainly don't have the list of questions. But you can predict some things that maybe the attorney might explore. And you can kind of go through those style of questions. So typically those questions are kind of yes-no questions, oftentimes leading questions. Just a little refresher about a leading question. A leading question is a yes-no question that it is phrased in such a way that it suggests a particular answer. Oftentimes it starts with, isn't it true that, isn't it true that you were born in February? When you hear that question, you understand the speaker believes that you were born in February. And that speaker is just looking for confirmation. Well, a witness, especially somebody who's, not a regular person to testify, who's already been on the witness stand, who just wants off of that stand, sometimes they'll agree to anything. I was born in February, even though he was really born in April. And so you have to practice with the witness so that he understands kind of how that works. That what is a leading question? It doesn't mean that the person asking the question has some secret knowledge and that you really can trust him when he says, isn't it true that, you should say no. If that's no, I wasn't born in February. No, not true. And so you can practice that. Another thing that's helpful to practice with cross-examination is that sometimes the attorneys who are cross-examining may try different approaches. They may try, sometimes they try to be very kind and sweet and likable, hoping to kind of persuade the witness to kind of change sides and be on his side. Sometimes they can be brusque and matter-of-fact. Sometimes they can be hostile, kind of mean, kind of ugly, to be honest with you. And so you have to consider or practice those things so that the witness can see that behavior and let you know kind of where the witness's vulnerabilities are. And you can also let the witness know kind of what's going on here. If the other attorney is brusque or rude or charming or nice or whatever, it's not really because that attorney really feels that way. He is in some sense acting. And so once the witness understands the reason for the behavior, then that kind of empowers the witness to get beyond that, kind of ignore the drama and just answer the questions. Preparing witnesses is something that both the paralegal and the attorney will do. Typically, the most important witnesses, it's likely that the attorney will prepare, the paralegal, even if the paralegal is not directly involved in preparing the witness, he or she may be present when that important witness is being prepared. And more minor witnesses, it's common for the paralegal to prepare. So that's an overview of that important part of the case. Here is an example of a timeline. Let me first talk about 2 months before the trial, 1 month before the trial, all these specific dates. This sounds like, you know, weeks ahead exactly and for certain when you're going to trial. That would be awesome if that was the world that we lived in. Unfortunately, it's really not. Let me kind of go back to my whiteboard for a second. And here we go. So we're going to clear. We'll go for blue this time. Okay. So let's imagine that we are in state court. And typically, trials, if they're going to begin in a particular week, are going to begin on Monday morning. And so this might be the docket that the court has. The first time you get on the docket, you're going to be down here at the bottom. And so think about it. In order for you to actually go to trial during that week, that first time you're on a docket call for trial, all five of these cases have to settle before you are going to trial. And keep in mind that if case, say, C had settled 4 weeks ago, it wouldn't even be on the list. So these are all cases that were still, you know, real cases up to a few days ago. Now, some probably will settle. Maybe C did settle. Maybe D settled. Maybe A settled. But the odds of all of them settling before your first trial date is probably not too realistic. So let's say that we are now down to B, E, in your case, F. So we have B, E, F. Okay. Well, B is going to go to trial, and let's say B is a 3-week trial. So next time you're up is going to be in 3 weeks. And so next time will be 3E, F, and there will be G, H, and I. Now, maybe E settles before, maybe E doesn't. Let's say E doesn't settle. So this is a 1-week trial. So now you are at, this is going to be your 1, 2, this is your third time up. You're at the top of the list. Okay, well, you know you're going unless you settle. So when you're at the top of the list, it's pretty confident you're going to go. So that's how it works in state court. In federal court, it works similarly, but there is a difference that's important to note. Most state courts, especially in larger counties, are going to either handle civil cases or criminal cases, at least for the most part. And so if you're having a civil case, the other cases on this docket call are also going to be civil cases, meaning they're not criminal cases. The person isn't face the potential of going to prison, for example. But if we're in federal court, typically federal courts handle both civil and criminal matters. So I'm going to clear this and go back to initial. So we have A, B, C, D. And let's say we're case D. This is our first docket call. A settles before trial. B settles before trial. C settles before trial. Oh, but look here. We have case F. This is a criminal case. And it actually could jump out of line and go ahead of you in this, and so that you don't actually go, even though the civil cases have settled before you. And this is because of both constitutional protections and statutory protections. There's something called the Speedy Trial Act, and this is, again, it's related to the constitutional speedy trial protections. But this allows, in certain cases, for criminal defendants to jump ahead of line. After all, let's remember that many times they are incarcerated. They are, maybe couldn't make bail. And so they are losing their liberty during this time. So it makes sense to let them kind of jump ahead of civil cases, because obviously no one's personal liberty is at jeopardy under those circumstances. So in the federal court system, it's not even guaranteed that even when you're at the top of the caseload that you're going to necessarily go first. Okay, let me switch. Back to where we were before. So we're back to the timeline. So again, when you see things like 2 months before trial, 1 month before trial, this would be before your first trial setting. So you're actually probably going to do some of these tasks more than once as you get closer and closer to trial. This is a checklist. And let me just pause and say that checklists are really important to the practice of law. And I would say that paralegals more than attorneys deal with checklists. They're kind of the guardians of the checklist to make sure everything is done. It's a little bit like if you had a surgery. You want the doctor and the nurses and the other medical professionals to be keeping track, for example, of all of the sponges that are inserted into your body, because if they put 5 sponges in, you want to make sure they take 5 sponges out. So you got to have that checklist. And there's just too many things to remember in surgery, and there's too many things going on to rely upon people's recollection. While we don't have life and death matters typically in a civil case, some of those issues are still in play. There's a lot of moving pieces, and so having checklists allows you to be confident that you're not forgetting something. So I encourage you to use checklists in your practice. There's lots of different sources for them. Lots of form books will provide them for you. They're just a sensible way of managing all that information. Okay, so in addition to getting the witnesses prepared, there's other things that have to be prepared for trial. And a big one are going to be any exhibits and witness displays that you're going to have for trial. Typically, this is a set of tasks that the paralegal takes a leadership role in. He or she may prepare the exhibits, but more likely he or she outsources that, maybe hires a company to prepare it. And nowadays, with all of the audiovisual options that we can use in the courtroom, many times these are rather elaborate and expensive productions, many times involving fairly technical, sophisticated approaches. So that can be a very rewarding, very satisfying part of your career to be involved in those types of tasks. They can be photos, they can be diagrams, they can be videos, and preparing them, deciding how they should look, hiring companies to prepare them, all that are commonly things that paralegals are involved with. You also want to see how you're going to organize these things. Of course, you'd work with the attorney for this, but the attorney may want to not show the jury certain exhibits until it's time to present that exhibit. Or there may be some reasons why they can't be shown to the jury beforehand. Maybe it's not clear that those exhibits will be admissible. So you may need to think through, well, how are we going to handle these? Where are we going to store them before we're ready to present them? So there's lots of interesting issues with that. Trial notebook is kind of the Bible, so to speak, of a trial. Back in the day when I graduated from law school, trial notebooks literally were that. They were 3-ring binders filled with various documents that relate to that particular case. You would have binder after binder after binder. You might have 20, 30 binders. One might have deposition of Bob, deposition of Bill, deposition of Larry. Then you might have another binder with pleadings in it, another binder with paper exhibits, lots of different things. And people still use the 3-ring binders. They're becoming less common to use, but of course the alternative is to use laptops and have that data stored on the laptop. I hate to make an unfair generalization, but the truth is that attorneys sometimes are a little bit intimidated by technology, and so they may not feel as comfortable with having it on a laptop as they would in a notebook. Also, there's the concern that, well, what if the laptop dies, or we run out of battery strength, or something along those lines. And so many times the attorney would like to have both the laptop and the actual physical 3-ring binders. So certainly you can have both. I would say Nowadays, probably most legal professionals are going to have most of their stuff on the laptop, but have at least the very most important stuff in Three Ring Binders as a backup in the event that everything else fails. Now, back in the day, the Three Ring Binder system was the best that we had, but it really presented some significant problems. Imagine that the attorney is examining a witness, and the witness says something that sounds like it's inconsistent with her testimony in her deposition. You're the paralegal, you hear that, and you remember the deposition testimony pretty well, and you want to find that section of the deposition that seems to contradict what she's saying now, so you can show it to the attorney, and the attorney can impeach her with that inconsistent statement. Well, back in the day of the three-ring binders, you were going to have to find the right binder, get it up on your desk, and flip to the pages. And you're going to have to do this before that witness is excused. And, you know, many times witnesses are just on the stand for a few minutes. So you are really kind of having to leap into action at that point in time. You just have a few minutes, sometimes just maybe even a minute to find it. And so you're kind of rushing around doing it. Well, imagine the jury members. They see somebody kind of spring into action and start doing this. They're fascinated. Well, now, what's going on? Why is that paralegal? They may not even know who you are, but why is that person on that side of the case? Why are they so excited suddenly? And so as a result, the jury oftentimes are now looking at you and not at the witness and not at the attorney. And so if the attorney was about to ask some really important questions, the jury could absolutely miss that. And so that's one of the problems with using the three-ring binders. If you're using a laptop, though, and you hear that inconsistent testimony, you're just hitting a few buttons on the keyboard, much less shuffling around, much less noise. The jury may pick up that you are intrigued by something, but it's a much less dramatic change. And so you're able to do it more discreetly, and you're also able to do it a lot faster. You can just do a word search to find that particular information. So you can find it faster, and it gives you that opportunity to get the information to the attorney so the attorney can decide what to do with it. Here are some examples of what might go into a trial notebook, whether it's electronic or actual paper-based one. You're going to want to have all the pleadings, all of the discovery items that can fit into a notebook, any motions. The exhibits, you also will have a case outline where you'll talk about where did each one of these exhibits go in. So if you know that, for example, Bob's employment application, you plan on getting that into evidence through Sally, the hiring manager. Well, if you forget to get that item admitted in evidence while Sally is on the witness stand, you may lose your opportunity. Maybe there's no one else who can prove up that document and get it into evidence. So you have this checklist for each witness. For example, you'll have certain things you want to accomplish. And some of it can be as simple as getting certain documents into evidence or getting certain agreements to certain facts. And so you want to have that timeline. Again, that kind of goes back to the idea of the checklist. So you have a list of what you need to accomplish with each witness. You'll have a list of the witnesses and the questions that you plan to ask. And of course, that is going to relate to the exhibits as well, because the way that you get exhibits in are through asking particular questions of the witness. But obviously, there will be questions in most cases that aren't related to exhibits, things that you'll want to have that witness admit to or agree with or whatever that particular case may be. In addition, you'll want to have sections that talk about important cases and statutes, not so much because you intend to share this with the jury. Obviously, the jury they're not legal professionals, so they won't know anything about those types of issues. This is for the benefit of the judge. Many times during a case, you are aware long before you actually get to trial what the issues are that may cause there to be some dispute between the between one side and another. For example, there may be an issue about whether that particular part of Bob's testimony is hearsay or not. It's your position that it is hearsay and should be excluded. It's the other side's position that while it may be hearsay, a hearsay exception fits to those circumstances, and so it should be admitted into evidence. Well, you'll have all of your cases and all of your supporting documentation. They'll have all their cases and supporting documentation. So when the other side asks the question that your attorney thinks calls for hearsay, your attorney jumps up and says, "Your Honor, I object," calls for hearsay, and then there's that discussion back and forth. And of course, you want your attorney to be armed with all these awesome cases that will help win the day. You can't predict every single issue that will come up. Sometimes it's obvious, certain ones it will. Sometimes there will be other issues that you prepare for, that you have all the cases and statutes lined up for. And you know what? It happens that it never becomes an issue. And there will always be a few issues that come up that you couldn't have anticipated, but you want to anticipate as many as possible so that your attorney can be empowered. Because if your attorney isn't prepared, but the other side is, who's going to win that one? Probably the other side. And then, of course, there's a catch-all, just anything else that seems important to that particular case, the things that you might need to have on hand. Okay, let's talk about the pretrial conference. Obviously, you can tell by the name that it happens before a trial. This is in with the judge. Sometimes it is handled in from the bench, from open court. Sometimes it's handled in the judge's chambers, which is really basically the judge's office. So that's more of a relaxed setting. Obviously, both sides are present. The judge has certain goals that he would like to accomplish or she would like to accomplish during the conference. Ideally, he or she would like to settle the case. And he or she is not above using some strong arm tactics to hopefully persuade the parties to settle the case. The judge can't force anyone to settle. That's a voluntary decision that they make. But both sides want the judge to be kindly disposed to them. And if the judge is saying, "Well, I can't believe, Bob, you're not willing to settle this case. That's an unreasonable position you're taking. You've got real exposure in this case. You need to settle it." Yes, Bob can say, "Nope, not going to settle it." And the judge can't make him settle. But the judge is going to be making rulings throughout the case, and the judge's body language and tone of voice, the jury members are going to pick up on. And so if the judge doesn't like Bob, the judge has subtle and not so subtle ways of communicating that. And juries pick up that, and juries respect judges greatly. And juries assume, sometimes correctly, sometimes incorrectly, that the judge has secret information. And so the jury assumes that the judge is in some sense communicating information when he seems to not like a particular person. So for those reasons, parties like to keep the judge happy and want to come in and appear reasonable in terms of settlement. So that's one goal, the settlement conference. Obviously, if the case settles, then the other goals really aren't important. But let's assume the case doesn't settle. So now we have the idea of narrowing the issues in the dispute. As I said before, typically both sides would like to have more time in front of the jury. The judge is going to limit their time. And so both sides are going to be thinking to themselves, how can I get everything in I need to? Well, one way they can address the issue is that there will be things that are uncontroversial. Even in the most heated disputes, there are plenty of things both sides agree about. Going back to the car accident situation, let's say that you're representing the plaintiff and he was in a car accident at the corner of Preston and Main in Frisco. And the other person was Sally. So your client's Bob. Sally is the person who's the defendant in the case. Sally and Bob have completely different understandings about the facts. But my guess is they both agree the accident happened in Frisco. And they both agree that it happened at the intersection of Preston and Main. They probably also both agree who was driving the two cars. They probably also agree what cars were being driven at that time. And they also probably agree about what time of day and what date it was at. They may disagree over lots and lots of important stuff, but there is almost certainly going to be some things that all the parties can agree about. And so if you can resolve those issues, you don't need to put testimony in about that. Let's say one of the issues in Bob's case is that it was a very sunny day, the day of the accident. Well, let's say that Sally agrees, yep, it was a sunny day of the accident. Okay, so now there's no need to present a lot of it as testimony about the weather conditions on that day. Both sides agree. They can stipulate that it was a sunny day under those circumstances. Another thing that can happen during a pretrial conference is establishing ground rules related to the evidence. It's not unusual for the parties actually to agree to admit certain a piece of evidence. There may be no dispute as to the authenticity of the document or its admissibility into evidence. So if that's the case, if both sides agree that this is an authentic document and that it is can be put into evidence, it may not make sense to require that party who wants to put into evidence go through all the technical rules of getting an item admitted into evidence. They may just say, okay, you know, if I won't contest the admissibility of your document 17 if you won't contest the admissibility of my document 24. And so you can do a little bit of horse trading to get that resolved. And that, again, speeds up the case, makes the case more interesting for the jury, so it's kind of a win-win. And so let's talk about motions in limine. Motion in limine is a motion requesting that certain evidence not be introduced or discussed at trial. And of course, the important thing is in the presence of the jury. So let's talk about what is going on with a motion in limine. First of all, both parties can put in motions in limine. You could have the defendant put it in or the plaintiff. Let me kind of give an example of how that might play out. This is a real life scenario. Go back to our whiteboard. Let's go with, we'll go with green. Okay, so we have an intersection here. And we have Pete, the big cement truck driver. As you will quickly see, I am the least talented artist you will ever see. But anyway, so here he's driving along this road. And I guess he's on the wrong lane, isn't he? Okay, well, use your imagination. He's going to turn up here. But he's going a little bit fast, or at least this is what Bob was in a car right here. And so Pete takes this curb a little bit too fast, according to Bob. And guess what? The cement truck topples over and squishes Bob. Bob's car is smashed. Unfortunately, Bob perishes. And so actually, Bob doesn't take any position in this case because he's not with us anymore. But Bob's widow, Mary, sues Pete, the cement truck driver, and Pete's employer, ABC Company. Now, Pete and ABC allege that it was really Bob's fault, that Bob actually hit Pete, and that's what caused Pete's truck to fall over. But they have a factual dispute, and obviously we'll have testimony about that. That's not what the motion in limine is about. Both sides recognize that there's going to be differing evidence that both sides are permitted to put in. But here we have a situation where one side wants to put in evidence that the other side thinks is fundamentally unfair. In fact, it's so unfair that it might prejudice the jury. It's more prejudicial than probative is the expression you'll hear. Let me write that up here. Oops. More prejudicial than probative. Okay, let's imagine that Pete is originally from Japan, and he overstayed a tourist visa. And he got a job at ABC, but you know what? He doesn't have the correct documentation to be here. So he is an undocumented person in our country. Obviously, the fact that he is here beyond his visitor's visa means that he has broken the law, and his continued presence is a violation of the law. Also, ABC violated the law by hiring Pete. They are required to have I-9s on all employees, and Pete... they don't have one for Pete, and they don't have one for Pete because Pete did not have the correct documents for it. And so ABC was in some sense complicit in Pete staying here, because if Pete hadn't gotten the job, he would have had to gone back to Japan. And so both Pete and ABC did not play by the rules. And so Mary would like to put in evidence about this, and her argument is this. I think Pete is lying about the accident with Bob. I think that Bob did not run into Pete's truck, that Pete just took the corner too tight and caused his cement truck to fall over, crushing my husband. So I think Pete is a big fat liar. And I want the jury to agree with me. And one of the pieces of evidence that I think will help me persuade the jury is that Pete stayed in the country beyond the date that he was supposed to, which speaks to his lack of character. If he overstays his visa, that's kind of like lying. And therefore, if he lied about his status in that sense, maybe he's going to lie during his testimony today. And so the jury, that's useful information so the jury can determine credibility. Pete and ABC say, well, yes, it's true. Pete has overstayed his visa. He should not be here, and we shouldn't have hired him. But that has nothing to do with what happened on that particular morning at that intersection. It's not as if Japanese cement truck drivers are more likely to tip over than American cement truck drivers. Pete's nationality would have had no impact upon that. Pete is completely fluent in English, completely knew how to operate the machinery. There's no reason that his nationality or his lack of U.S. legal residency would impact that. So those are kind of the two conflicting arguments. Pete and ABC would file a motion in limine requesting that the judge prohibit any witness from talking about Pete's immigration status during the trial, saying it's irrelevant. What's relevant is what happened at that intersection on that day, and that has nothing to do with Pete's immigration status. In this particular case, let's imagine that there's another twist to the case. In order to drive the cement truck, Pete should have had a Texas commercial driver's license. He didn't have a Texas commercial driver's license. He does have a commercial driver's license from Japan. But the requirements for a commercial driver's license in Japan, I'm making this point up, I don't know if this is true, are somewhat less strict than the requirements in the United States. And so perhaps Pete's training was less onerous in Japan to follow those particular rules. So it's very possible that the judge would agree with Pete and ABC about whether Pete's undocumented status would be allowed into testimony. But the judge might say, Mary, you can't ask witnesses about the fact that Pete overstayed his tourist visa, but you can get into evidence the fact that Pete should have had a Texas commercial driver's license, that ABC should have required that Pete have that before he got behind the wheel of the cement truck, and that Pete, in fact, did not have that license. And so that would be an example of a situation where the court would say, the lack of a Texas commercial driver's license is more probative than prejudicial, but the fact that Pete did not have the correct documentation, that testimony would be more prejudicial than probative. So that gives you an idea about motions in limine. So we're looking for, so the things that might be excluded are if it's more prejudicial than probative, whether evidence is completely irrelevant, or whether it's inadmissible for some reason. This would be a way to resolve those admissibility issues so you didn't have to delay the jury with argumentation between the two attorneys and speed up the progress of the trial. We are now to the trial, we're now on the day that the trial is beginning. Let's put it that way. We're in the courtroom. The pretrial conference would have probably happened maybe the Friday before trial. So now it's Monday morning. We know we're going. It's clear that we're the next trial up. The first thing you have to do is you have to select a jury. In Texas, really anywhere in the United States, the process by which you select a jury is this one. Is it these two words? If you took French, you are aware that it's pronounced voir dire. But in Texas, we don't pronounce it that way. We pronounce it voir dire. I'm not sure what the history of that is, but this is an example of an important idea in the law. It's not particularly proud of it, but it's true. Is that when you are a legal professional, you want to fit in. You don't want to be hometowned. So if the attorneys in that particular market, say Vaudreuil, even if you are a native French speaker and find it ridiculous that you're saying Vaudreuil, guess what? You say Vaudreuil. That's what the judge is used to hearing. That's what he knows. And then when you go to New York City into a courtroom there, or Chicago or LA, and they say voir dire, you're going to say voir dire. You're going to fit in that sense. So what is voir dire? And this would be true whether you're in Texas or in federal court. This is the process by which you select your jury. So you'll have this panel of potential jurors, and obviously there'll be many more people on the panel than can actually be on the jury. And so one of the things that you'll be doing along with the other side is trying to figure out who on that panel is going to be best for us. Let's imagine that you are in federal court. Let's talk about the way that it typically happens in federal court. In federal court, let me put it this way, most federal judges give the attorneys in voir dire very limited opportunity to ask questions. What they will oftentimes ask is that the attorneys ought to submit questions to the judge, and the judge will decide which questions to ask the jurors. The judge will probably have some set questions that he or she always asks, things like, do you know me? Do you know the attorneys? Do you know the parties? Those types of questions. And then a few other questions that the attorneys submitted. The judge will typically read those questions to the jurors, and that is how it proceeds. It's typically a relatively boring, quick process. And so once all the questions are asked, the attorneys get to then challenge any of the jurors for cause. The attorneys can challenge as many jurors as they want to for cause. Let's say that one of the jurors answers a question in a way that suggests that he or she has some bias against or in favor of one of the sides. Let's say he says, well, I just feel like anyone who tells lies about somebody ought to be executed or something. And let's say that the claim is that your client defamed somebody. Well, you might be very concerned about that person being on the jury. And so you might say, well, Your Honor, I don't think that juror 17 can fairly and reasonably consider the evidence in this case. I would like for him challenged for cause, meaning that his bias is so strong that he can't overwhelm it and that he ought to be excused. The judge can grant those, and sometimes will grant those, but there's a pretty high standard here. The judge is not going to grant, in most cases, very many of those, and it has to be a pretty clear-cut bias situation. And so you can make those efforts, but you're probably not going to get very many people kicked off for that basis. So once you have all the challenge strikes, then you're ready for the peremptory challenges. And this is really where most of the people who are going to get off are going to get off. The number of peremptory challenges you have is limited. It varies from court to court, but 3 is a pretty common number. And so you have to, you know, kind of jealously guard these and decide where ought to use them. A couple things to keep in mind. Let's say the panel has 50 jurors on it. Well, if you have 3 peremptory challenges, the other side is 3 peremptory challenges, and there's only going to be 12 jurors plus 2 alternates, and you have 12 plus 2 plus 3 plus 3. So that would be 14, that's a total of 20. So there would be no sense in using one of your peremptory challenges for juror number 48 or juror number 49. After all, the odds that you're going to get that many cause strikes would be so, so unlikely, unless it's a very, very unusual case, that you'd be wasting your time in those cases. So you're going to focus your peremptory challenges probably in the first, say, 16 or 17 people on the jury panel, people who definitely will be seated unless somebody kicks them off. You can use a peremptory challenge for any reason other than an unlawful reason. Many attorneys have kind of rules of thumb that they use. Sometimes they're kind of goofy. I've heard of attorneys who will always strike number 13 or number 7, or they might strike somebody who has, who was born on St. Patrick's Day, or, you know, whatever goofy thing that person might have. Sometimes it's a little bit of luck or not luck, superstition, I guess you could say. But most of the time, the attorney is going to base his challenges on some idea about the ideal juror that he or she seeks. Now, you might have some ideas about the people that are more likely to be on your side. For example, you might think that people who live in rural areas are more likely to be on your side, or people who have experience working with their hands might be more likely to be on your side, or people who enjoy to read in their leisure time might be more likely to be on your side. And so if you find somebody who doesn't meet those characteristics, you might decide to strike those folks more readily than other folks. Now, I said you can use these strikes for any reason other than an unlawful reason. And examples of unlawful reasons are you cannot strike someone because of their race or their gender. Imagine for a second that your client is an African-American person. He's the plaintiff in the case. He was in a car accident with an Asian-American, and he's suing the Asian-American, saying it was the Asian-American's fault. In your jury panel, say 20 in the first 20 in the panel, 10 are African-American, 5 are Caucasian, and 5 are Asian. You might think to yourself, oh, I would prefer to get those Asians off because I'm concerned that maybe they might feel some kind of sense of connection with the defendant. But that would be an unlawful reason. You can't let the ethnicity of the jurors be a factor. Also, you can't let the gender. Again, let's say it's your client's a man, the defendant's a woman. You can't strike women because they're women. You can strike them for another reason, but you can't strike them because they're a woman. Now, you may think to yourself, well, how will anybody know the reason I struck that person? And it's true. No one can know what's in your heart, but you're not supposed to do it. If it appears, let's say, going back to the example of the African-American suing the Asian-American, if I use my three strikes all on the first three Asian-Americans in the jury panel, that looks pretty suspicious, right? And so the attorney for the Asian-American would probably make a Batson challenge. That's what we have here. Batson was an important U.S. Supreme Court case. And so what he would do is say, I make a Batson challenge. I think that race was a factor in the peremptory challenge usage. And so then the attorney will come back to me and say, okay, well, explain. Why did you pick these three individuals to use your peremptory challenges? And then it'll be the judge's decision whether it really was race or whether it was something else. Obviously, I need to have a very good explanation if it really wasn't race. So that's how that works. We go to the next slide here. So what does the parallel, so we talk, actually, let me go back here and talk a little bit more about voir dire. We've talked about how voir dire happens in federal court. Let's talk a little bit about Texas state court. Voir dire is often used in Texas state courts as a way for the attorney to make a human connection with the jurors. It's also a way for the attorney to introduce the jurors to some themes that are going to be coming up in the case. So many times the attorneys aren't really asking questions that are so much designed to find out what the jurors are thinking, but more to get the jurors kind of agreeing with the attorney and kind of sharing the attorney's point of view. So you might have an attorney say something like, who thinks it's good to be fair? Well, no one's going to oppose being fair, so everybody's going to say, raise your hand, oh yeah, I think that's good. Who thinks it's a good thing when people help other people out? Who's going to object to that? Of course, people are shaking their heads. And so the idea is that the attorney is causing the jurors to kind of get used to agreeing with him and get used to thinking that this attorney is a pretty reasonable guy or woman for that matter. And so during this process, the attorney is oftentimes almost a performer. He's really trying to get the jurors kind of involved and engaged in this process. As a result, he's not necessarily looking at all the jurors individually. You know, after all, there may be several people on the panel, you know, maybe 40 people on the panel. So it's just not possible to be looking at all 40 at the same time. So oftentimes the paralegal is really involved in seeing who's paying attention to the attorney. Someone may be on their phone. Somebody may be, you know, gazing off into space. Those are probably not jurors you want. Or maybe the juror's kind of making a face at the attorney, doesn't seem to like what the attorney's saying. Or maybe the juror's kind of making eyes at the attorney from the other side and seems to be engaged with that attorney. Again, all those would be indications this juror might not be the best candidate. And so the paralegal can help the attorney decide who based upon their body language and the way they comport themselves, most likely to be kindly disposed towards your client. Another thing the paralegal can be involved with, this is oftentimes more before voir dire, is actually proposing and drafting the questions. What kind of questions do you want to go? And again, yes, you'll ask things like, you know, do you know this person? Do you know that person? But you can also ask questions that set up the themes of your case. You may also want to think about a jury profile. Who's going to be the best people for our jury? Sometimes juries have more than the 12 jurors. Juries can be less than 12. If it's a smaller case, they may only have 6 people on the jury. But if it's a larger case, it's going to have 12 people. Especially if the case is going to be of a fairly long duration, things can happen to jurors. Jurors may have health issues or family crises, things like that come up. And so it's not unusual that there's a decision made that there will be one or more alternate jurors. These jurors are segregated to some extent, but they hear all the testimony. And if one of the jurors has to be excused because of whatever reason, then that first alternate will join the jury panel, and now he or she is a real juror. So that's what the alternate juror, what that means. Okay, so now we've selected the jury, and now we're ready to talk about what's going to happen at trial. Let's first of all focus on what the paralegal is involved with. A huge part of most paralegals' jobs in trial is organizing logistics. And I would argue that a huge part of most paralegals' jobs in and out of trial, whether you are a trial paralegal or not, is organizing logistics, is getting all of the pieces to work together, is getting information to the right person and organizing it and presenting it and getting your hands on it quickly and all that kind of stuff. Being a very organized, very logical, very methodical person really, really pays off big time for the paralegal. So when I say logistics, I mean making sure the witness is going to be there on the right date at the right time, and they know where to be, and they know where to park, and they know how to dress, and all of those thousands of questions that each one of the witnesses have, the paralegal has anticipated it and given that information and sent the reminder notes and done all that kind of stuff to make sure everything is as seamless as possible. But then there are other things, too. I mean, how are the attorneys going to get to and from the courthouse? I mean, there's going to be banker's boxes of exhibits. You're going to need a dolly. Who's going to remember to get the dolly? Well, the paralegal's the one that's going to remember to get the dolly. All of that kind of stuff. Organizing the documents. Of course, this is part of the logistics, but making sure they're arranged in those trial notebooks in a way that you're going to be able to find it really quickly. It's intuitive. You know it. You know it like the back of your hand. You're going to be monitoring testimony for inconsistencies. Some of the witnesses, you'll know more about his or her testimony than the attorney will know. And the attorney has lots of things on his or her mind beyond maybe looking for inconsistencies. So your job might be really to listen for differences in the testimony between what this witness is saying today and what he or she said at the deposition. And then, of course, once you find that inconsistency, you're going to spring into action and find that inconsistent document that can be used to impeach the witness. In addition, you're going to want to observe the juror's demeanor. Are they engaged? If they seem really interested, it may be good to send a note to the attorney saying, you know, expand upon this. They're engaged. If they seem like they're dozing or not engaged, you may send a note to the attorney, you know, shut this down. Move on to another topic. This isn't intriguing them. Different attorneys have different philosophies, but many attorneys don't like to look at the jury too much when they are asking the witness questions, that may seem a little bit artificial and too just not the best. And so the attorney may not be in a position to evaluate how the jurors are responding to that. It's common for the paralegal to take notes. Attorney is going to have to compose his closing statement without any transcripts from the court. The only thing he will have is his own recollection and the notes that you have. So if you can get some lovely quotes that the witness said, that's really, you know, the attorney can come back and say, Bob said, and I quote, blah, 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 blah. And that's the important thing. That can be really, really powerful. So taking those notes can be helpful. It can also be helpful in terms of some of the motions that you file, the post-trial motions, because again, you're not going to have the transcript at that time. So all you're going to have are your notes to use. Maintaining a trial journal is very similar to the notes. It's a more organized kind of skeleton set up for the trial, for everything that's happening at trial. Getting witnesses ready and in the courthouse, getting them to the right place. Sometimes almost having a welcome wagon of greeting people, telling them where to go. Problem solving. Somebody needs to make copies. Somebody's starved for lunch. It's downtown and you can't find a parking space. You know, all of those issues, there's going to be 1,000 of them, and somebody needs to be the one who's going to be the go-to person for it. And many times, if I have to say most of the time, it's going to be the paralegal. Okay, so this is about the paralegal role. Now let's talk about what happens at the very beginning of the trial. The jury's been sworn in. Now we're ready for opening statements. The person who gives an opening statement is the plaintiff. The plaintiff has that opportunity really for two reasons. First of all, he bears the burden of proof. He has to persuade the jurors that it's more likely than not that his version of the facts are what really happened. Let me flip over to the whiteboard for a second. And talk about the three levels of proof. The first one, which is the one we have mainly in civil cases, is the preponderance of the evidence. This is the lowest evidentiary proof that are required. Sometimes it's referred to as 51%. It just has to be more likely than not. The highest level of proof is the beyond a reasonable doubt. This is only required in criminal cases. There is a third level of proof, which is not commonly used. It is sometimes used both in the criminal context and the civil context, and that is clear and convincing evidence. Let me pause here and say there will be a test question at some point in this course on clear and convincing evidence. When I say clear and convincing evidence, I don't mean that all it has to be is clear and convincing. This is an evidentiary standard. So these words they're terms of art. They have a special meaning kind of beyond their obvious meaning. What it means is that the evidence is really strong on a particular issue that has to be proved. And oftentimes they'll say that the in order for the jury to find clear and convincing evidence, the jury has found, jury has a settled feeling that something happened a certain way. It doesn't have to be up to beyond a reasonable doubt. They may think, you know, well, I have a settled feeling, but I could be wrong. And they could still have that settled feeling. They still have satisfied the clear and convincing evidence threshold. You might look upon this as maybe a 75 to 80% odds. So don't fall into the trap of thinking clear and convincing evidence just simply means evidence that is clear and evidence that is convincing. It is an evidentiary standard. But for most of the cases, this is going to be the standard. It's a very low evidentiary burden, but it does mean if there's a tie, if the jurors say, you know what, we found the plaintiff and the defendant equally credible, we just don't know who to believe, then under those circumstances, the defendant wins the tie. And so that's one of the reasons why the plaintiff goes first, because the plaintiff does bear this additional burden. The other reason that the plaintiff goes first is that the plaintiff is the one with the beef. After all, the defendant in many of these cases is looking at the situation saying, I don't know why we're here today. I don't think I did anything wrong. So if you don't think you did anything wrong, why would you start it? I mean, what are you going to say? Well, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I did nothing wrong, so let's go home, right? It only makes sense to be the defendant when you're responding to what the plaintiff has already said, because the plaintiff is going to say, defendant did something wrong. So kind of logically, it makes sense for the plaintiff to go first. Okay, I'm now going to switch back to PowerPoint. Okay, so the first person who starts is going to be the plaintiff, the plaintiff's attorney. The plaintiff's attorney is going to make an opening statement. After the plaintiff's opening statement, typically the defense makes an opening statement as well. It is true that the defendant can choose to wait on his or her opening statement. That is rarely done, but it can be done. Studies of juries indicate that jurors pretty much decide at the end of the opening statement whom they believe. And that is a pretty good predictor as to how they're going to rule. Now, that's not what the juror is supposed to do, but it's what the jurors actually do. So the opening statement is incredibly important. Let's pause and talk for a second about why the jurors are not supposed to do that. Well, first of all, the jurors aren't supposed to do that because the attorneys are not under oath. They are telling a story. They are not, the pains and penalties of perjury haven't attached. Number one. Number two, the attorneys have no firsthand knowledge of the circumstances. They weren't there when the events that are the subject of the lawsuit even happened. And so even if they were under oath, they wouldn't be able to testify in a meaningful way about the events because they're just relying what they've heard from other folks. So for those two reasons, what the attorney's saying isn't evidence. It's just one version of the story. Let's talk about why opening statements are so important. And part of this has to do with kind of the reality of courtrooms. Okay, so let's go with blue this time. Okay, so let's imagine that this is a very simple case. We have four witnesses. One, two, three, four. These are the four witnesses we're going to call. And there are, we'll say that there are 10 important facts in our case. Witness A can testify to fact A, and witness 3 can testify to fact A. Witness 2 can testify to fact B, and so can witness 3. Witness 4 can testify to fact C, and so can witness 1. Witness 1 can testify to fact D. Witness 3 can testify to fact E. Witness 2 can also testify to fact E. And witness 2 can testify to fact F. Witness 1 can testify to fact G. Now, in a perfect world, and let's say that assume that fact A happened first, the best way to present this story would be to have all of your fact A witnesses present first. So you'd have 1 and 2, and then you would have, 1 and 3. Sorry about that. And then for fact T, you'd have 2 and 3. Then for C, you'd have 1 and 4. And D, you'd have 1. And for E, you'd have 2 and 3. For F, you'd have 2. And for G, you'd have 1. So you'd have witness A up there 4 different times. Witness B up there 3 times. Witness C up there 3 times. Witness 1, 2, and 3. Witness 4 up there once. But the reality is it's just not reasonable, especially if this trial is going to last, say, 4 days, to hold these folks, hold witnesses 1 through 4 hostage. They're kind of bouncing up and down off the witness stand. That doesn't make sense. So what you're going to do is you're just going to call witness 1 time. But he's going to talk about this fact and this fact. And this fact, and this fact. So if in order to really understand fact D, you need to know fact B, well, A can't tell about fact B. He has no firsthand knowledge about fact B. So what are you going to do? Well, you might say, well, let's call witness 2 first. Okay, well, let's do that. So witness 2, instead of calling witness 1 first, you call witness 2 first. And so, yeah, he can talk about B, and he can also talk about E, and he can talk about F. But you know what? To understand fact F, you really have to understand fact D, and B can't talk to fact D. Okay, so you can see how you're never going to have a perfect order of witnesses so that you're going to have this seamless story. But you use that opening statement. So what you do is you tell the story to the jurors. You say A happened, and then B happened, and then C, and D, and E, and F, and G. And you might even say, now, witness 1 is going to be able to tell you about this, and witness 2 is going to be able to tell you about this, and witness 4 is going to tell you about this. So kind of prep the jurors so that they know when Bob, who's witness 4, gets up on the witness stand, he's going to be able to tell you about fact C or whatever it might be. So by having this kind of structure, this paradigm, this outline in the heads of the jurors, and the jurors are able to process the information a little bit better. So in addition to the jurors just finding the overall, that they can find the story told by the attorneys to be very persuasive and powerful, you also have this role that the attorneys are making a roadmap of the case. They're telling them where the stops are, what the facts are. They're presenting them in chronological order. They're able to describe what the evidence is going to be, both the testimonial evidence as well as the documentary evidence. And then they can also present the legal theory of the case. This is one thing that the witnesses can't do. The witnesses aren't going to testify to the law, but they can talk. The attorneys can talk about things like what's the burden of proof and what's the elements of that particular tort or whatever the matter is. So you get to get into legal theory as well. So after both sides have presented their opening statement, now the plaintiff gets to present his case first. Again, he gets to do that because he has that burden of proof. So he calls his first witness. And so any witness that he calls, that witness is going to be considered a friendly witness unless there's some reason to think he's not a friendly witness. And so that examination we call direct examination. With direct examination, the attorney cannot ask leading questions. Again, those are leading questions that suggest a particular answer. Isn't it true that, or you ate Chinese food that night, didn't you? Those types of questions that are yes or no and that suggest an answer. You can't ask those of your direct examination witnesses unless, of course, that particular witness is hostile, and then you can do that. You may think, well, why do you treat them differently? Well, I said before, witnesses on the witness stand oftentimes will kind of agree with anything that the attorney says because they think the attorney knows more information. But even a witness is smart enough, you know, to figure out, hey, this is the attorney for the other side. He isn't on my side. He's not my friend. So I should be pretty careful about agreeing to what he says. And so they're a little bit more circumspect in that situation. Another reason why leading questions are not permitted for friendly witnesses is that the friendly witness has had a lot of time to prepare with the attorney and with the paralegal for that side. And so they've had the opportunity to rehearse and to say, hey, when I ask you this question, I really want you to focus on this particular part of the story. So there's really no need to have leading questions because you've had the conversations about what this question is about beforehand. After the plaintiff has completed his direct examination of his first witness, then the other side, in this case the defense, gets to cross-examine that same witness. Because, of course, if the witness was friendly for the plaintiff, the witness has to be hostile for the defendant. So leading questions are permitted. Cross-examination is typically a lot shorter than direct examination. The goals that the attorney for the other side might have can vary, but oftentimes it's to show holes in the witness's credibility, or perhaps there might be something even that hostile witness can say that will help the defendant's side. Now, of course, given the fact that we have all this extensive discovery before trial, both sides know the strengths and weaknesses of each witness and the different things that witness can testify about. So typically, in the direct examination, any really zinger things, the plaintiff's attorney is going to address those in the direct examination to kind of diffuse them. And so usually there's not a lot left for cross-examination. So let's say that, again, it's a car accident case, and you have a friendly witness who's testifying that it really was the defendant's fault that the car accident happened. But an unfortunate fact is that the witness wasn't wearing her glasses at the time, and her vision isn't the best. And so that's an unfortunate fact. Well, you know it. You know the other side knows it. So you're going to ask about that. And it comes across to the jurors like, oh, you know, look, he even asked questions that aren't good for his side. So it buttresses up the credibility of the plaintiff's side by asking those questions. But more importantly, it takes away that zinger aspect. So you might say something like after you get all the testimony, you know, well, Mr. Smith, I see that you're wearing glasses today. Were you wearing glasses at the time of the accident? No, I wasn't. Oh, okay. Do you only need them for reading? No, I need them for vision and reading. I had broken them 3 days before, and I said my glasses weren't available to me at the time of the car accident. And then I might say something like, without your glasses, do you still feel like what you've testified to is what you really saw? Yep, I'm certain of it. Okay. Thank you. No more questions. And so now the other side, yeah, they can ask questions about the lack of glasses, but it's already been really addressed and resolved. So again, cross-examination is oftentimes either non-existent or very brief. After cross-examination, then the case goes back to the plaintiff. The plaintiff can ask redirect questions to the witnesses, and they can go back to recross and go back and forth and back and forth until all the questions are exhausted. There are some rules about this that are kind of beyond the scope of this course, but typically you just have direct and cross, and then it's time for the next witness. Let me go back to one thing that I failed to mention before, and that is when the plaintiff's attorney calls the first witness and he asks the questions, he's going to also get in any evidence that he needs to, such as documentary evidence or physical evidence or things like that. And of course, in the cross-examination, documents and other things can be brought into evidence as well. So the plaintiff goes through all of his witnesses until he's done, until all the witnesses are over. And now it's time. Oh, here's an example. For example, direct examination questions. I'm not going to read these right now. If you want to read these at your leisure and give you a sense as to how direct examination questions work. And here are some examples of cross-examination. You can see that typically the question is lengthy, the answer is short. Question, more lengthy, answer is short. Here is a little reversed, short questions, long answers. That's what you would expect. So plaintiff's case has closed. Plaintiff has presented all the evidence that he or she wants to or is able to at this time. At this time, the defense is almost certainly going to move for a directed verdict. What is a directed verdict? Well, directed verdict is, or a request for a directed verdict, is a request that the judge dismiss the lawsuit, direct the verdict of the jury. In other words, take the case away from the jury and say, plaintiff hasn't won his case. The idea here is that at this point in the case, all of the things that the plaintiff wanted to say about the case has been said. All the evidence has been presented. And the defendant is saying, given all of this evidence, Your Honor, they can't win. They haven't met their burden of proof, and so therefore you have to dismiss the case. It is possible that the judge will grant this motion, but it's very unlikely. It's rare for a judge to grant this motion at this time. After all, in most cases, he will have already denied a motion for summary judgment. And so if he really was persuaded the case was super, super thin, he could have dismissed it already. So most of the time, the defendant who moves for a motion for summary judgment really doesn't think he's going to win this. He actually does this for another reason. He does this because it's necessary for a later JNOV motion that he's very likely to file later on. We'll talk about what a JNOV is later on in this presentation. Okay, so We have the directed verdict. And again, the basis of the motion is there's a lack of evidence to support the plaintiff's case. One of the reasons that the judge is unlikely to grant the directed verdict is that if the judge grants a directed verdict, it's pretty likely that the plaintiff is going to file an appeal. And if the appellate court concludes that there was just enough evidence that the case should have proceeded, then that appellate court is going to remand the case back to that trial court, and they'll have to start the whole trial over. All the witnesses that were called the first time are going to have to be recalled. A new jury is going to have to be found. So it's going to be a restart of the process. So, you know, nobody wants to redo something that doesn't have to be done. And so for that reason, judges often as will say, we've gotten this far in the case, just go ahead and take it to the end. So the next part obviously is going to be if the motion for directed verdict is denied, then the defendant does the same thing that the plaintiff has done. Calls his witnesses, asks questions on direct. Again, these are now the friendly witnesses for the defense. Plaintiff's attorney gets to do cross and so forth. After the defendant's case, then the plaintiff's attorney has the opportunity to present a rebuttal case. Let's say that the defendant has raised an issue that wasn't part of the plaintiff's case in chief. So therefore, the plaintiff really hasn't had an opportunity to present witnesses that rebut what the defendant is saying happened. This is its opportunity. This is the plaintiff's opportunity to do that. And so you occasionally will have a rebuttal case. It's certainly not a given. Most of the time you just have the plaintiff and then the defendant, and then you go to closing arguments. And so we're ready for closing arguments. Again, the plaintiff starts first because the plaintiff bears the burden of proof. And again, those lovely notes that the paralegal has taken are oftentimes the skeleton, the bones of the closing statement. In this time, the attorney tries to summon up all of the reasons, all the arguments, all the storytelling and legal theories that he hopes will persuade the jury to rule for his client. Typically, the plaintiff will go first, but the plaintiff will reserve a portion of his time, not use it all initially. Then the defendant will go and make his closing statement, and then the plaintiff will come back up because he's reserved that little bit of time and make the final plea. So the last sound that the jury hears is going to be the plaintiff's attorney's final close. After the closing arguments, then the jury will hear the jury instructions. This is also called the jury charge. These actually have been a work in progress between the attorneys and the judge as the case has gone forward. And the judge will have requested in jury instructions from both sides, and both sides will have prepared them. Obviously, the plaintiff prepares jury instructions that he feels will favor his client, and the defendant has prepared jury instructions that he feels will favor his side. Obviously, the judge wants instructions that don't favor any side. Because jury instructions are a pretty common basis for cases to be overruled, the judge is especially interested in making sure that the jury instructions are good. And so the judge will look at the instructions that are submitted and come up with a version that he or she thinks is the most fair. The jury instructions are not going to instruct the jury on how to interpret the facts or what actually happened. That's the purview of the finder of facts, which in this, if you have a jury, that's what the jury does. What the jury is responsible for is finding facts. The judge is responsible for identifying the law. So the judge gives the jury what the law is. And so that's the role. So he explains how the law works. Of course, if you have a bench trial, you don't have a jury, the judge acts both as the finder of fact and the finder of law. So after hearing the jury instructions, the jury is excused and they begin the deliberations. Once they have reached a decision, then we're ready for the verdict. And that's when we find out which side won. This is an example of a jury charge. This is a questionnaire that the jury completes. It can be as brief as one or two sentences or one or two questions, or it can be hundreds of pages long. They're almost a little bit like, I don't know if you can remember this from your childhood or if you did this, but there were these books once upon a time that were called something like Choose Your Adventure. Anyway, you would start reading it, and then at some point you would have to choose, do I, you know, walk through the deserted town, or do I stay put and wait for mom to come back, or whatever the thing is. And so it will tell you, well, if you decide to walk through the deserted town, turn to page 57. If you decide to wait for your mom to come back, turn to page, you know, 93. And so then you find out what happens. Anyway, so there's these series of decisions that you make. Well, the jury charge kind of is this way. If you answer yes here, then you go to this other question, and so forth and so on. You don't answer all the questions because you're making choices along the way. And again, the complexity of the case is going to turn out how many pages this might be. So now we have the end of the trial. The jury has been excused. One side has won, one side has lost. And so we're going to look at post-trial motions. Inevitably, the loser is going to file some motions at this point in time. The first motion that he's probably going to file is what's called a JNOV. We already talked about this previously. You may recall that's the motion where we had to have the directed verdict motion filed first in order to have the opportunity of filing for a JNOV. A JNOV stands for Judgment Non Obstante Veredicto. That's a Latin, obviously. But many times, instead of calling it a JNOV, JNOV is a common name for it. But many times, people will translate English and they'll call it a motion for judgment notwithstanding the verdict. And you can see this would be a JNTV. So people don't abbreviate this. So they either say JNOV or they will say this longer expression. But you can see the letters don't match up between the two. So when you file this motion, what you're saying is, Your Honor, the jury got it wrong. You just need to overturn their verdict and say that we won because we're the ones who should have won. There was something obviously wrong with what the jury did. And again, I said, you can't even file this motion, or you can file it, but the judge won't even consider it unless you file that directed verdict motion previously. This motion, the JNOV, is a long shot. Again, the judge is more inclined, although I will tell you, the judge is more inclined to grant a JNOV than a directed verdict, because at least we know how the jury is going to rule. So if the judge grants a JNOV and then the case is appealed and the appellate court concludes that the judge shouldn't have granted the JNOV, that what the jury decided was appropriate, there doesn't need to be another trial. The jury's initial verdict will just be reinstated. So it's not that fear of we're going to have to do this over again. But still, judges are loath to grant JNOVs. They're loath to overturn the decision of the jury. It happens. Certainly, there are motions like this that get granted, but it's a long shot. But again, never hurts to ask, I guess. So once the JNOV gets denied, then the loser gets to file a motion for a new trial. This is less advantageous for the loser than the JNOV, because the JNOV changes you from a loser to a winner. Just like that. Motion for a new trial changes you from a loser to a let's run the race again position. If you lost once, you may well lose again, but at least there's a chance you might win. And so what you're saying here is the trial was in some sense fundamentally flawed. Perhaps there was jury misconduct, perhaps there were prejudicial jury instructions, lots of things that can go wrong. And you can imagine that a judge is not going to say, oh yes, those jury instructions I read were prejudicial. They were so awful. Well, no. So most of the time, you're really criticizing the judge. Well, both of these motions, you're really criticizing the judge, saying, Your Honor, because you screwed up so badly, we need to have this case overturned. You can imagine that's not the most persuasive argument for the judge to hear. Sometimes it can be juror misconduct, which might be outside of the control of the judge. But oftentimes you're pretty much saying, you screwed up, so give us a new trial. And that's oftentimes not a winning argument. But you oftentimes do have to file a motion for a new trial in order to be able to pursue certain types of appeals. So sometimes it's done not because you think you're going to win, but because there's procedural reasons it has to be done. These motions are often supported by affidavits and memorandum of law. Again, that legal research that you did prior to trial might well be part of this memorandum of law. But let's say you've lost both the J and a V and your motion for a new trial. What are your options? Well, you can settle, certainly, but you can also proceed with an appeal. You have one automatic right to an appeal. So you get that first, you have to pay for it. I mean, you have to file the right paperwork and you have to pay the fees, but the first court can't turn you down and say, we're not going to hear your case. The appellate court is going to review what happened in the trial court and look for errors of law. They're not going to be looking for factual conclusions that were drawn. For example, let's say that your client thinks that the other guy ran a red light. The other guy says, no, the light was green when I entered the intersection. The jury concluded, yes, it was green. Maybe the jury was wrong. Maybe the jury was right. But that's what the jury concluded. You're not going to be able to persuade the appellate court that really the light was red and that the jurors were wrong. The appellate court knows that it wasn't at trial. It wasn't in a position to view the body language and the demeanor of the witnesses. And so it knows that it's in a really, really bad position to make credibility determinations. So it's very unusual for it to overrule a jury on factual issues. But it will overrule the court on legal issues because you didn't have to be there to know what the law is. The law is the law whether you're in the courtroom or not. And so the appellate court feels very comfortable saying that's a misstatement about the rule of law. The appellant, you can see here the word aunt here, the appellant is the loser at trial who wants to appeal the case, files a notice of appeal, and then the trial court clerk prepares and forwards the record on appeal up to the appellate court. So you can see the appellant is the person filing the appeal. The appellate process, the appellate court, is a neutral. They're not any particular person's side. Many times the appellant is called the plaintiff of the appeal. And you can see how just like the plaintiff in the trial court was unhappy about something that happened before the trial. That's why he's suing, right? Well, the appellant is unhappy about what happened at trial. He's mad. He's appealing to get that problem solved. The person who is defending what happened in the trial court is the appellee. He is like the defendant. Hey, your court of appeals, everything was fine. The trial court, just keep whatever they said and not make any changes to it. Both the appellant and the appellee file appellate briefs, and there's usually going to be an oral argument. The appellate court is going to issue a decision, and these are the most common options that the court can have. It can affirm what the trial court did, which means it basically gives it an A. A, affirm, the trial court did a great job. We're not changing anything. Awesome, awesome. Or they can reverse or vacate. There's some differences between the meanings, but for the purpose of this class, it's basically like getting an F. They're saying the trial court screwed up big time. We're going to have to make that go away. And then the middle one is modified. It's kind of like getting a C. Trial court got some things right, got some things wrong. Kind of that middle of the road approach. Then we have remand. A remand is typically going to happen. It doesn't happen in every case, but when you have a reversal, a vacation, or a modification, oftentimes you have a remand. You're not going to have a remand if a case is wholly affirmed. A remand is when a case is sent back to the trial court for further hearings. Imagine, for example, that the court granted a directed verdict. The plaintiff then filed the appeal. The appellate court agreed with the plaintiff that the directed verdict shouldn't have been granted, so they vacated that directed verdict. Well, there's nothing to put in its place because we don't know what the jury would have done. So in addition to vacating the case, they have to remand it back to the trial court so that we can have another trial, right? So when the appellate court renders its decision, there's still something that still has to be done. The appellate court's not probably going to do it. The appellate court's, for example, not going to conduct the trial itself. It's going to send it back down to the trial court to handle that particular issue. many times there's going to be multiple issues of on appeal. The appellant is probably going to have, and they might just have 1 point, but more likely than not going to have 3-4 points, something like that. And so it might be that the first point gets affirmed, the second point gets reversed, the third point gets modified. So things can be in whole, meaning the whole, all issues raised are decided the same way, or certain issues can be decided one way and certain issues can be decided the other way. I don't want to leave you with a misapprehension or misconclusion about this. Only about 10% of cases are appealed, and only about 10% of appeals are successful. So that means about 1% of cases are overturned on appeal. So the vast majority of cases, what happened in the trial court is what becomes the final decision. So I don't want to make it sound like this is the usual way that most of the time they get reversed. No, that would be a bad indication about our civil system, because that means our judges aren't doing a good job initially. Okay, let's talk about enforcing a judgment. We've gone through all of the appeals and we have a final judgment. So now the winner, let's assume the plaintiff won. So the plaintiff has the opportunity to collect his judgment, and obviously he wants to do so. Collecting a judgment can be difficult. It can be especially difficult in Texas. Texas is generally a pro-debtor state. It is difficult to collect judgments against individuals. Not corporations, but individuals, it's hard to collect judgments. A common tool that the successful plaintiff is going to use is a writ of execution. The word writ just means court order. So a writ is a court order. A writ of execution is a court order directing the sheriff to seize assets to sell to satisfy a judgment. So let's say that typically when you have a final judgment, typically the winner or the plaintiff will go to the defendant and say, hey, you owe me $100,000. Give me my money. If the defendant doesn't pay on his own, then that's when the writ of execution issues. And then the sheriff comes and says, well, okay, you know, you owe plaintiff $100,000. Looks like that computer over there is worth maybe $5,000, and maybe that desk over there is worth $2,000. Anyway, they just start calling things out that are worth up to $100,000 to satisfy that judgment. A judgment creditor is a creditor who holds the court's judgment against the debtor. This is more common when you're talking about individuals. So let's say that I am an individual who's been sued, and I don't have insurance to cover this, and so the plaintiff sued me, won, and has a judgment of $100,000, but I don't have $100,000. Well, then a plaintiff becomes my judgment creditor. So when I get more money, it can come in and say, okay, you got to pay me more money, you got to pay me more money, and that can go on, well, forever, until I die. And then whatever I owe at that point becomes the possession of the judgment creditor. It may seem surprising that cases still get settled at this late date, but it does happen because it can be very timely to collect a judgment. As you said before, there's lots of tricks that can be played in this situation. You may recall back when O.J. Simpson was not incarcerated, back in the 1990s, you may recall that he was prosecuted criminally for the deaths of his ex-wife and another gentleman. He was acquitted of that charge, but he was, in a separate trial, found civilly responsible for their deaths. And the jury in that case awarded significant damages to the estate of the ex-wife and the estate of the man who was killed. But it was very difficult for those judgment creditors to actually collect the money against Mr. Simpson. And Mr. Simpson, I think, would go around to various places and sign autographs in kind of for money, would sign them for money. And so what these judgment creditors would do is whenever Mr. Simpson was paid to be at these events and would get paid, then they would try to collect that money right then and there. This went on for years and years. So, you know, it can be a very involved, time-consuming process to collect the judgment. Expensive, time-consuming, just overall difficult. And so if you can say to the debtor, you know, if you'll pay me 80%, you know, right now, well, we can just kind of go about our business and go you know, do our own things at this point in time, as opposed to me, you know, stalking you for the next 20 years. So that's sometimes what happens under those particular scenarios. Okay, so here's kind of a summary of the things that we've already talked about. We've already talked about the role that the paralegals have before trial, preparing or following the pretrial checklist, finding the witnesses, subpoenaing them, organizing and preparing the exhibits, and organizing and preparing the trial notebook. We talked about the pretrial conference, the possibility of settlement at that time, and the possibility of motions in limine. We talked about voir dire and the role the paralegal has in that process and how voir dire works in Texas. We also talked about the various parts of the trial, the opening statements, the plaintiff's case in chief. We have the motion for directed verdict and the defendant's case in chief, the possibility of the plaintiff's rebuttal case, closing arguments, jury instructions, and a verdict. And then we have some motions that can be filed post-trial, the J&OV motion, motion for a new trial, or an appeal. And we talked about the collecting of a judgment, how difficult that can be. If you have questions, please feel free to bring them to class. I'd love to hear them. And I'm sure if you have a question about it, somebody else in class probably shares your question. So thanks for your attention. Have a good day.